The only thing that puts you and me at a disadvantage is our lack of knowledge concerning history.
That while the Greek Bible is accepted by 99% of Christian theology, the Greek Bible, I believe, has trouble reflecting some of those idioms, metaphors, and understandings of the East. Where the Aramaic is an Eastern language, it's consistent with those traditions and understandings and axioms of the East. And when I started reading the translation from the Peshitta text, the Aramaic text in the English, I found it very rich, very revealing, and frankly changed my whole view of Jesus and some of his metaphors and idioms that he would speak about. For example, when Muslims say hello, they say salam alaikum. That means peace be with you. When Jews say hello, what do they say? Shalom, shalom aleichem, which is the same as salam aleikum, is peace be with you. Now, what did Jesus say in his Aramaic vernacular? Shalom aloch. You hear this? It sounds, they're all identically the same. Now, one of the more interesting things, getting back to, I told you, the paradigm crash, did Jesus really come here to convert people to the Christian religion and the Christian faith? The very interesting thing about the word convert, which is used 10 times, incidentally, in the King James Version, in the English translation, the word convert, often used by Jesus, is the word shlama. The word shlama, or shalim, is the same word as shalom. It's the same word as in the Arabic salim, which means peace. But it also means something other than peace. It also means to submit, to surrender, and to turn around. So therefore, when Jesus used the word go make disciples or converts of nations, he used the word shalim, meaning go make people who will submit themselves to God, not change their traditions, not spit in the face of their families and say, I've now changed membership in cultural traditional clubs from, let's say, the Muslim club to the Christian club.
Namayiznikom Daudi Sanatani Resha Diavella Sigimim Betele and Radafuli Irdifunakom Altikalon Ifemanakma.
The Arabic language, by its nature, has been preserved intact, unchangeable, with the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Arab grammarians and the Arab lexicographers were the first people. The first dictionary in the English language is 16th century. They don't even know really what Chaucer's language meant. They can only guess at a lot of words, the meanings of words. The Hebrew language, the Hebrews caught on to dictionaries from the Muslims. And this is why in modern biblical studies in Tel Aviv and the universities where they study, they go to Arabic roots to understand the Bible. This is a fact that I'm not making this up. They go to Arabic roots to understand the Bible because they recognize that as a Semitic language, it is the only language that has maintained a lexical purity that other languages have not maintained because of the preservation of our scholars. And by the tawfiq of Allah, because when Allah said, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, that includes the preservation of the Arabic language because it's an essential aspect. The Arabic language has been preserved, and it's there for whoever wants it. If you want dunya, then learn English. But if you want akhirah, learn Arabic. Because it is the language that literally opens up a whole world of meaning that is inaccessible in the English language, and I'm saying that as somebody who is bilingual, who reads the Quran in Arabic and reads English. The Arabic, the Quran is not the Quran in English. It cannot be called the Quran in English.